To enjoy this one as we get ready to begin the second half. West Virginia on top of Connecticut, the number 9 team of the country by 7. What we saw that first half of play was really kind of a tale of two halves. West Virginia came out with a lot of early shooting, got Connecticut back on their heels, and the Huskies seemed to find themselves.
Well, they certainly have. We talked about it in that half. You saw a lot of young players learning on the job for Connecticut. You know, obviously confused by the different defenses, they started to pick it up. But when you talk about getting it done for West Virginia, it's been a mix of youth with Deshaun Butler, as well as experience with Frank Young. You know, two of these guys obviously helping West Virginia to vault out to the lead. And for UConn, it's been all youth. Doug Wiggins particularly, without him, you wonder where UConn would be. Wiggins with 10 points in 14 minutes of play.
Take a look at those first half stats. Now, UConn has been holding the opposition down to 33% shooting. West Virginia shot 48% in the first half. UConn also with a whole bunch, almost 150 points in the paint over their last three games. They haven't been scoring on the inside.
Well, they haven't. And again, West Virginia's done a nice job of limiting the fast break opportunities for UConn. Only 4 points off the fast break. And would you believe it? As well as UConn rebounds offensively, as far as second chance points are concerned, West Virginia leads 13-11.
Connecticut does have an all-time lead in the series between these two teams. In fact, at 11-2 mark for Connecticut, the only time that West Virginia beat UConn in a Big East matchup was back on February 11th of 1998. They won it by 18 that day. Now they've got the ball and the lead with 20 minutes to go.
So the other area where UConn certainly has to improve, they're going to get back into this ball game, is the free throw line. They missed 9 free throws in the first half, which is pretty much the difference.
There's an emphatic beginning of the second half for Joe Alexander.
Again, you knew UConn was going to come out very aggressive defensively. So did West Virginia, and they ran that play to perfection.
Good ball movement for the open jumper on the baseline. Marcus Johnson burying it from 18. He got a feeling there's a lot of game left in this 19 and a half minutes.
Oh, there's no question about it. We talked about the young players for UConn learning on the job, learning how to solve the zone. And West Virginia with a lot of confidence offensively.
Young, the turnaround. And just a different look at how they're addressing the trap defense now, finding the open man in the corner after driving to the middle.
Well, they take the double team, UConn does, very nicely. And when there's a little bit of gap in that double team, look for the guards to continue to drive it. And now you got an advantage situation, penetration, kicking the jump shooters.
That's a nice adjustment at the half by Connecticut. Alexander, nice. Guys, Matt's feet moving. And a reach-in foul.
Well, Joe Alexander obviously showing some very sound fundamental basketball with the ball fake. And here, just a quick drive using his left and finish with emphasis.
Foul we just saw was Jeff Adrian's third. That bears watching. And off the miss. Wide open shot on the inbound. Here comes UConn. Straight up the floor. And right out of the hands, ahead of the back of Adrian.
And Jeff Adrian complaining that he got pushed, but man, you get on the baseline, you got to be strong with the ball.
He'll take a seat now, sitting with 3 fouls and replaced by Stanley Robertson, another freshman. West Virginia has led by as many as 12. UConn's only lead in this game. Leads in this game were early. And Nichols fouled. Getting a little tighter with the whistle as A.J. Price gets called for the reach-in.
Now, if I'm A.J. Price, I know who's back there. I've got a guy blocking over 4 shots a game. I'm going to funnel my guy there, but I don't have to put my hands on him. I don't have to even block his way because look who's there. Let him drive.
That's a great safety blanket back there for a defensive player. And it lets Connecticut even take more chances on the outside.
Absolutely. That's what it's all about. That's why you can step up and pressure.
Nichols hitting on the first. Best free throw shooter on his team. And tied for 15th best in the NCAA as recently as a week ago. He hits a pair and he's got 6. West Virginia again by 9.
There's the drive at a gap. Negates the double team.
Price. Great job of creating his own shot by working his way around that zone. The foul call is going to be on Summers. That'll be the big man's second. And free throws coming out for A.J. Price.
And it's going to be important for UConn to continue to get to the free throw line. I mean, West Virginia is third in the nation and the fewest, fourth in the nation and the fewest fouls allowed, or the fewest personal fouls, which is only less than 14. UConn's already been to the line a tremendous number of times. I think it's like the 18th free throw or 19th free throw they've shot.
It's number 18, or 17, I should say. This will be number 18 here. Price is sophomore, but there's 2.5 years between competitive basketball games before starting out the year this year. And how about that? A chance at a three-point play off the missed free throw.
Stanley Robinson getting in quickly. That's just a mental breakdown by Virginia. Watch Robinson at the top. And Alexander just lets him push him too far under. Once again, Joe Alexander, look how far under he is. Too late.
What an athletic play from Stanley Robinson, a freshman out of Birmingham.
You got to step across if you're on that inside line. You got to step across, get the guy on your hip.
Connecticut kept the ball alive, but West Virginia out of the pack with it, working with a 6-point lead in the basketball.
There's the back door. Nice.
Alexander had to change his shot mid-flight. Did a great job at doing it. Super athletic play, and he's going to go to the free throw line.
And again, we talked about in the first half, whenever it goes to Summers, he's looking for back door. My wonder is why the beat is playing that tight on Summers. If Summers has the ball out there beyond the arc, I'm stepping back into the paint, and I'm taking away the backdoor passes.
Joe Alexander said last year he learned how to play basketball as a freshman. Playing for John Beilein. How much of what this team is trying to do offensively is reacting to what the defense does in front of them?
Oh, it's everything. It's all about reading and reacting, as you just mentioned. You know, you take what the defense gives you and you learn how to read. If they're going to play over the top, you go back door. If they're going to play kind of below you, you step up and step behind the screen and shoot the jumper. We've seen that time and time again. Frank Young's a good example.
And of course is the defensive end of that 1-3-1. Connecticut's done a much better job this half of breaking it. Dyson way outside. And that fight for the rebound, I believe the foul call is going to be on Alexander. Crowd doesn't like it. Nor does the head coach.
Well, John Beilein is obviously expressing his displeasure because that was just a hustle play. Take a look at the jump shot right there. Here comes Alexander. They're just hustling for it. Yeah, his arm came down onto Beats, but you know, both of those guys are going after it strong. Now see, he's holding it over his head right now. Got to get it up a little higher.
Alternate possession. Ball stays Connecticut's way.
He's starting to get there. It was right near his forehead. Now if he could just get it over his head, no one can reach it.
Not anybody in this building anyway. 7'3".
There's a step ladder over there that you might climb on.
Sitting back 2-3 now on his own. Not a look they've shown a lot of this afternoon, just once before. And Robinson can't hit the finger roll. Here come the Mountaineers. Good job defensively adjusting by Connecticut. And then a reach in. And the foul call will go on Marcus Johnson. Nope. Gonna say no foul call, just off Connecticut.
See, that's the gamble that you're willing to take when you know if the beat's back there, you know you're not gonna get a layup.
Shot clock down to 10 now. No backdoor cuts to be had. Ruah from way outside. And the offensive rebound, Young. It won't fall. And Connecticut clears the board away. Other way. Transition basketball and a blocking foul going to be called on Ruoff.
That's a tough position to be in if you're Alex Ruoff. You got the very athletic Jerome Dyson bearing down on you. And you're trying to step in and take position, but Dyson able to change off the fly, change direction to draw the contact.
So it is Dyson to the free throw line. And the beat both started their season on ESPN2. So as Dyson hits out of second, we've got a 6-point ball game. And once again, very aggressive from Connecticut up on top. And it creates a turnover. No. They say it last touch Dyson, who can't believe it.
Stifling defense by Connecticut. Again, they've continued to put the pressure on West Virginia, and that'll wear you down mentally over time.
And that's going to be a reach-in foul. So the ball will go back to West Virginia when we come back. But it's Mountaineers who've led more or less throughout.
Scott Reese, a Stanford guy, couldn't help but hit a glee in his voice.
Yep. That's quick hands. Not quite quick enough. Nichols has it knocked away. Crowd wants a goaltend to go with the foul, and it doesn't look like they're going to get it.
Again, we talked about the pressure, how it wears on you mentally as well as physically. And again, just another opportunity for UConn, but a missed opportunity as West Virginia gets it back.
A foul and a block. And it sends Nichols to the free throw line.
But the one thing, if you're on the Husky bench, you got to keep your guys focused on doing the same things. Obviously, John Beilein asking for the foul on the reach across. But you want to keep, if you're a Husky supporter, you want to keep your guys focused and aggressive. Because ultimately, it will pay dividends.
Take a look at the rebounding now. And surprisingly, in some ways, West Virginia right there with UConn. There's that 1-3-1, wreaking havoc again. Bowinkle can't hit it.
Well, you saw the rebounding numbers. Connecticut came into this game with a plus 15 rebound margin advantage. So obviously West Virginia holding its own and then some.
Mountaineers who played very well, but Huskies are right in this game. And Johnson working his way through the crowd.
And now Connecticut is starting itself on the offensive glass. They're starting to go get to their strengths now. And I think that the pressure, the full court pressure, starts to take its toll a little bit on West Virginia.
You can see it bothered again and again. 22, 25 feet from the hoop. And you got a hold. Coming defensively, going to be called against UConn, and the foul call will be against Stanley Robinson. That's Robinson's first.
The other reason that UConn can continue this pressure is because they've got depth. Now, we're not saying that the guys coming off the bench are, you know, any more experienced than the guys that are on the floor, but Jim Calhoun sees a pretty level line among four or five guys that he can essentially make interchangeable, and he keeps coming off with different guys, keeping them fresh, keeping the aggressiveness on the defensive end.
Down the lane, that's a pretty move from Joe Mazzola, the freshman in Jackson, Rhode Island.
Nice jump stop there, drove the lane with no fear.
Summers, good stop defensively. And the Mountaineers control the ball.
I'm surprised there's no call. A lot of contact underneath the ball, underneath the basket.
Now a wide open transition game breaking out.
And how about Deshaun Butler? Deshaun Butler demonstrating, obviously, he not only can play that Mountaineer team game, but he's also a terrific one-on-one player.
You would think this wide open game would favor UConn, but right now, West Virginia using it to their advantage. They lead by double digits again.
Just about all of the games last year, except for maybe one or two, and then Marcus Johnson played 20 games, and that's it. And they're sophomores.
They're without a scholarship senior player on the roster this year. They learn it as they go. Missoula gets fouled off the rebound, so back it goes the other way.
And that was a big mistake by Doug Wiggins again. Freshman mistake. After he hit the jump shot, or shot the jump shot, he started to step back two or three steps. That ball came right back to the spot where he shot it. And Missoula beat him to that spot, and that's what caused the foul. You shoot a jumper, you hit the ground. Instead of falling back, you've got to recognize maybe you got an opportunity to rebound. Somebody else has responsibility for back deep if you're shooting.
And Johnson will take his seat. And another try for the freshman. Led Rhode Island Division I in scoring as a senior last year. And on the board again now as Ruoff will come back in. Nichols goes back out. Substitution pattern continues for the Mountaineers. Wiggins found his way inside, but then into further trouble. Dangerous along that baseline.
Well, Jeff Adrian tried to make that cross the lane pass to Jerome Dyson waiting in the corner and wound up hitting Frank Young smack in the chest with it.
Knocked away from Price and taken right back again. Not a lot of flow to this possession on either side. And Price got it on the glass. Not good enough. Transition again for the Mountaineers. Oh, my, the look away from Ruoff. Biggest lead of the game for West Virginia.
West Virginia taking a page out of the Husky playbook. Solid defense, push the ball up the floor in transition. And here's where the true challenge comes for the young Huskies. This crowd is on them. This crowd is also lifting the confidence of the Mountaineers. And you got to weather this storm.
And if you're West Virginia, you continue to feed off it. That's exactly what they've done. Good cross-court look. And they find the open man. That stops the crowd in its tracks as Doug Wiggins hits from 22.
And at some point, I'd say, wouldn't you know it, it would be a freshman. But, you know, obviously, Connecticut has no choice. It's going to be a freshman or a sophomore.
There's a backdoor look, which West Virginia lives on. Alex Ruoff, their leading assist man, throwing that pretty pass. It's been a well-played ball game.
And too many points in the paint forces Jim Calhoun to bring Khabib back into the ball game.
Adrian flying in to keep the rebound alive. Not once, but twice. And the foul call will be on the floor, I believe, on Deshaun Butler. Excited fans here in the hometown. They've got a 13-point. Here, West Virginia is 13 ahead of Connecticut, and you like what they're doing in terms of the offense.
Sure, they're using the Connecticut aggressiveness against them. Watch Jeff Adrian right here. He's going to turn his back as Frank Young goes in and goes back door. And he never looks at the ball. You see, Adrian, number four, never sees the ball. And that's the worst sin you can commit defensively, not to see where the ball is.
Two opportunities close to the basket. Don't fall for the Huskies now. And it looks like West Virginia has weathered the storm from Jim Calhoun's team. They came back into this game, got it back within five, but now it is blown back up to a double-digit lead again. Full court pressure. This has worked at times for Connecticut. There's going to be a foul.
Again, a little lack of experience, but there's no lack of experience here. Nice job of coming to the penetration, and then you see Thabit trying to clear the defenders. Nice block right there. And once again, instead of clearing with the elbow, you got to pull the ball above your head if you're a guy at Thabit's size.
That's the third foul at Thabit. And now there's going to be a hold on Connecticut. Curtis Kelly gets it for the foul.
And to go back to Thabit's foul, whether he made contact or not, you know, he swung enough to allow the defender, in that case, Ruoff, to act if he needed to. Now, I don't know if he hit him or not. I got a feeling if he hit him, he'd still be on the floor right now.
That reaction looked a little bit delayed after the elbow went by. Alexander the miss. And with 11 and a half to go, Connecticut trying to climb back uphill again. Huskies, a team that hadn't trailed since December 6th against Northeastern. They have been used to playing from behind. Price, tough angle off balance.
And that's a perfect example, recognizing time and score. It's not about Price going one-on-one.
Threw off the miss, and it's going back the other way.
You know, in a situation like that, you've got to let a lot of guys touch the ball. You've got to have some opportunity. Jim Calhoun's asking what happened with a call on A.J. Price. He's fallen way off balance. Had to be bumped.
With 11:05 to go, the UConn timeout. And West Virginia comfortably on top of this 13-point lead. You think West Virginia basketball, before he was the logo in the NBA, he was the all-time leading scorer here. Of course, talking about Jerry West, number 44. Also averaged double digits in rebounds, led the team to a national runner-up in the NCAAs in 1959. And the retired number 44 for the all-time career leading scorer in West Virginia.
And look at those numbers, particularly the 13.3 rebounds. We think of Jerry West as the consummate backcourt player. But in college, even at 6'3", 6'3 and a half, with those very long arms, he's a tremendous player in the post. We saw in those two highlights.
And a chance for the West family to continue. There's his son, Johnny, who's a redshirt freshman here at West Virginia.
I don't know if Johnny's arms are as long as his dad's. I'm sure he's got that sweet jumper, though. That's got to be genetic.
And Jim Calhoun just got teed up. He was going after Reggie Greenwood in that timeout. Greenwood was on his side of the floor as they started play again. And apparently, Jim Calhoun went one step too far.
Well, Jim Calhoun certainly has to be disturbed by the lack of calls on his end of the floor right in front of his bench when some of his guys are getting bumped on shots and there's no call. And then on the other side, you know, there's a beat elbow or a purported elbow and some of the other calls that West Virginia's been getting away from him. You know, sometimes coaches feel like they're being disrespected when they don't get the same calls in front of their bench.
Considering how big the hill is and his team's climbing up today, that's 2 points he could not afford to give up. They are now stuck 15, biggest deficit of the day. And off the miss, Ruoff trying to save, and he ends up getting an assist the wrong way.
Well, I think UConn's strategy right now is that once their guys drive the gaps and get an advantage situation, they just want to get it up on the boards. The guys on the baseline are pinching in. They're going to try to corral and get second and third chance opportunities and put the ball in the basket. Nothing fancy about that strategy. Just shoot it and go get it. That was definitely a foul. And once again, goes to inexperience at the beat. You know you want to bump cutters, but you don't do it so blatantly in front of the officials.
And that is number 4 on the big man. Hashim Thabit with his 4th foul will go to the bench. And here's what you're talking about.
Now watch the cutters coming through. Look at the elbow raised above his shoulder. Then he puts his hands up like I didn't do anything. You know, if you're going to bump, and even though that's a point of emphasis that you allow cutters through and players shouldn't be bumping the cutters, but even if you're going to make contact, you do it with your hips and your shoulders. You don't just blatantly put an elbow up and throw it.
All part of that learning process for a young man without a lot of basketball experience. And we said for now, though, with the four fouls, he's going to take a seat.
We'll see how that plays, because UConn probably a little more mobile going out and pressuring people and playing the high post passer without the beat in the game. But obviously they can't be as aggressive defensively, because if they make a mistake and West Virginia bears down, they don't have that shot blocker, that eraser back there to help.
Young hits that free throw. He's now got 17 to lead all scorers.
And the reason why I put the emphasis on the defense, because that's what's going to get UConn back if they have a chance. It's going to be on the defensive end.
There's good ball movement against the zone, perhaps the best we've seen so far. And Dyson nailing a three.
Because out of defense, that creates a lot of the UConn offense. You know, you're going to get shots like that. You're going to get guys knocking shots down. But if you're going to come back from this kind of deficit, you need some easy ones. Come on, help.
And once again, the foul call.
And obviously the fact that the beat's not in the ball game is not lost on West Virginia. Mazzulla, as soon as he gets it, he's driving to the basket. No fear, because this intimidator is nowhere to be found.
Well, the big man is sitting with four for A.J. Price. That was foul number three. And one more try, Kelly, with a 13-point lead now for the Mountaineers. Three of the other ranked teams came into the day unbeaten today. UCLA, Oregon, and Clemson. And right now, with under 10 minutes to go, that undefeated season for UConn is in serious jeopardy here in Morgantown. And he traveled. Price switched hands on a crossover, but the ball never touched the floor. And the 12th turnover for Jim Calhoun, Steve. Long range. How about that? Young's got 20. Leading scorer for these Mountaineers is lighting it up. And that pretty much says it all for the way this run of game has gone for UConn.
Well, we mentioned in the first half that early in the season, Frank Young was getting booed, started off three of his first 18, and people had such high expectations of him. But, folks, this man can play, he can shoot, and he's the guy that may lead West Virginia to the promised land. He certainly is today.
This is some kind of effort for the Mountaineers here this afternoon, and it's got to be a little bit of a wake-up call for the Huskies. Still 9 minutes to go, though, and they are not out of this game as yet. All off the end line, it'll go back the other way. Ohio State.
A couple of years ago, Temple visited Cameron Indoor and gave the Blue Devils all they wanted under Fran Dunphy, a new style.
Intriguing matchup.
And Duke, after the game against Gonzaga last week, essentially learning how to win. A young team that's learning how to win.
Here this afternoon, you've got two young teams that have spent the early part of this season learning how to win. Right now, it's going a little bit better for West Virginia. Connecticut is a team coming into the day averaging 83 points per game. You know they've got instant scoring in there. An unbeaten team. And you know that they're going to make at least one run to try to get back into this thing with 8:10 now left to go in the game.
You know, again, that offensive rebounding and second chance opportunities are a given with the Huskies, but they're going to have to win this game, I said, on defense. They're going to make some stops.
Now there you go. There's your stop. And now here's your transition. And a good look. Look out. Here they come. Back down to 13 now with 7:50 to go. 16 on the game for Marcus Johnson.
From West Virginia, no more quick shots. I'm running my stuff right now. Try to melt some time off the clock, force UConn to make mistakes on the defensive end.
Seven left to shoot. Pretty move inside, won't fall. And the Huskies are at it again. Price had it knocked away.
And that time it looked like a foul or asking for a call. The referee Tim Higgins was right on it, though, says it was a deflection. But everybody on the UConn bench jumped up, thought they got a foul call.
Roth down the side. That's a pretty take down the lane.
Again, without the beat in the ball game, West Virginia very willing to take it all the way to the basket.
Johnson trapped down in the corner. And you've got contact. And the ball back over to Connecticut when we come back. Nice take down the side of the lane as West Virginia continues.
Jim Calhoun's credit, he jumped, he asked Tim Higgins, and Tim Higgins signaled that it was a deflection, and he shook his head, okay. Calhoun. Very tough call there.
Calhoun has already been teed up if he joined us late. The technical foul here in the second half. West Virginia has done a very good job of keeping Connecticut at arm's length. UConn has had some mini runs, but haven't put together a big one, and now it's getting late. Shot clock winding down. It won't fall, and then contact on the rebound. The foul call will go on Wiggins. It'll be his third.
And, you know, here comes the inexperience again. The freshman receiving the ball after running their sets. Still about 7 seconds left on the shot clock, but the crowd behind him is counting 3, 2, 1, and Wiggins actually rushed that shot as though he was listening to the crowd.
And the big man at the beat still sits with his 4 fouls. Certainly has changed the way that Connecticut has approached things defensively. But a lot of things that West Virginia have done in this game have also done that. Deshaun Butler's had himself a terrific game with 16 points. Big part of what happened in the first half of the Mountaineers. And there's a back door that was right there, but catch couldn't be made. Didn't matter. Sometimes it's just your day.
That's right. Everything going right for the Mountaineers. And a lot of that's created again by your own hustle, by your own confidence.
Stanley Robinson back into the ball game. Well, this year, West Virginia was picked 12th in the Big East. John B. Lett said, I don't care. Pick us wherever you want to pick us. Last year you picked us 5th. We ended up 3rd. He's not worried about where the expectations are.
I think John relishes the underdog status. I mean, it helps with the motivation of your team.
Team that was picked 5th last year, made it to the Sweet 16, at least that far for the 2nd year in a row. Field goal shooting 49% and 17 for 22 from the line for West Virginia.
Well, again, we talked about West Virginia leading the nation in points allowed, holding teams to 26% from beyond the arc. You know, this is a quality defensive team, and that's their hallmark. That's their foundation.
Coming up on 5 minutes left to go, and the Mountaineers can afford to play with a lot of patience. Right of that shot clock down to 5. And late in the shot clock, you're going to get a foul call going back the other way, or 5 seconds? I believe the call was 5 seconds.
Yeah, that was turnover.
It was strange because it didn't even seem like he had full control of the basketball to be called for 5 seconds. And the other way, just too strong.
Well, this is the weakness of this Husky offense. They don't have that knockdown shooter. Remember Rashad Anderson? You know, he could come up and hit those long shots off the penetrating kick. Nobody on this team yet. I think Doug Wiggins might be the one guy who can do that. You look at A.J. Price, you look at Jerome Dyson, they're more slashers. And in this kind of game, when you're playing this kind of defense, particularly the zone, you got guys who are penetrating the gaps. You want to kick to somebody who can knock those shots down. And UConn's going to have to find somebody to do that. Otherwise, they're going to face an awful lot more zones.
And one step closer to 21-0 under Beilein at home in December. Nichols got 14 on the game. Four different Mountaineers in double figures.
Look at Darius Nichols once again. Little change of pace and then goes straight to the cup. And Jeff Adrian late. And Adrian not a true center, so he doesn't anticipate as well as, say, Thabit would or any other shot blocking center.
Adrian right there. And you wonder about Adrian. He's got great size early in the season, non-conference games. He was working pretty well in the middle. Is that going to work in the Big East?
No. Jeff Adrian's going to need some help along the front line. Like I said, a hard worker, a guy that's always around the basket, averages 4 offensive rebounds a game. He can do that. He did that for the most part last year, but he was playing behind some pretty terrific frontline guys in Boone and Armstrong. But in the end, he's going to need help, and that's where Thabit is going to have to start to learn, start to increase that learning process.
Butler to miss. It's 3 in a row that he has missed now. August Johnson making his return.
And when you look at this score, and again, not to say that UConn doesn't have another run in him, but as you mentioned, Scott, they're running out of time. Talking to Jim Calhoun today at the hotel before the game, and he recognized that this was a possibility because of the youth of his team. You're playing a tough place like this, you know, your first conference game, in a hostile environment, so to speak. You know, it's an amazing thing what happens to players when they get on this floor. You know, all the things that you've been trained, all the things you've been drilled at run out of your head when you have these other things that, you know, kind of distract you.
You didn't necessarily want your kids to learn this lesson in a conference game, but you'd rather have them learn it in December than learn it later on.
Absolutely. And this is a team that's going to get better. You see they've got the talent. Well, West Virginia's going to get better, too.
West Virginia has played a superb basketball game today. Connecticut just isn't hit.
Right. They just don't have a jump shooter out there right now that can do it. As I said, Wiggins probably the only one. Here he is scoring 2 feet from the basket. Got to develop some standstill, some catch and shoot jump shooters.
He's got 15 for the game, but we near 3 minutes now left to go. And the lead is 15.
It's another measure of balance for teams. You got good penetrators. You still need the guys who can catch and shoot the jumper.
Talk about the learning process game this was for Connecticut. What a big victory, assuming they're hanging out here. This is for West Virginia in terms of their confidence, in terms of what they do for John Beilein, this fan base. They've got to be awfully excited about where this team is headed now.
Well, they certainly should. Again, when you lose Kevin Pitsnoggle, a Mike Gansey, Joe Herbert, J.D. Collins, you know, you lose those guys, teams that have gone back-to-back deep into the NCAA tournament, you kind of wonder, okay, what do we do for an encore? But, you know, Frank Young, one of the holdovers from, you know, that mini dynasty for 2 years, has really led the way for West Virginia. And he's done it from the perimeter. Little penetrate kick, put it on the floor. And again, and for the third time, I mentioned the fact that I just can't understand how anybody could have impatience with a guy like that who's waited his turn behind those guys I just mentioned to become the star. He's learned, he's been an apprentice to those guys. Now it's his time to shine. Give him a chance. You know, give him a chance, and this is what you get.
At 20 is one shy of his career high. 4 out of 9 from 3-point range, 7 out of 14 from the floor on the afternoon. So with under 3 minutes to go, tactical timeout taken by the Mountaineers. And they look to close this one out. Nichols never hit the rim, and back they go the other way. And right